And I would also like to thank Vebleo for giving me this chance to share our results on the integration of hexagonal semiconductor zinc oxide with other cubic functional oxides. And I'm also glad to have this opportunity to listen to three very wonderful talks before mine. Okay, my name is Hui-Qiong Wang. I'm from Xiamen University, China, as well as Xiamen University, Malaysia. So first of all, well, I would like to introduce the beautiful campus of our campus university in China and also in Malaysia. In China, our campus was named one of the most beautiful campus in China. And actually this year we are celebrating the 100th anniversary of the university. It was, and then in Malaysia, we are also celebrating the 5th anniversary this year. Actually, our university was founded by Mr. Tan Kah Kee 100 years ago. He was a very successful businessman in Malaya at the time. So now we go back to Malaysia to set up this branch campus because of this historical connection. And of course, it's because of the invitation from the Malaysia government. So all of you would have a chance to visit our beautiful campus either in China or Malaysia. Before my talk, I also want to acknowledge the wonderful team effort from my co-authors. So in Xiamen University, we have an MBE facility led by Professor Kang, and actually my three PhD students work on the projects that I'm going to share today. Professor Zheng in Xiamen University, China and Malaysia help us with the density functional theory calculation. We also have the previous opportunity to conduct institute molecular beam epitaxy, and as well as the chamber that was attached to the photo emission station in Beijing synchrotron radiation facility led by Dr. Wang and Professor Kulash. And we can also institute characterization of X-ray absorption spectroscopy. And in order to investigate the nanoscale in interface structure between the two different materials, we have the expert from Brookhaven National Lab, especially in Professor Zhu's group. They help us with the high resolution TEM, scanning, tunneling, transmission electron microscopy, as well as the electron energy loss spectroscopy. Okay, so zinc oxide is the typical wide band gap semiconductor. In at room temperature, it crystallized in the hexagonal structure. So actually a lot of people choose hexagonal substrate to grow this type of material. However, we choose a different substrate which has cubic structure because we saw that in some cases, there's the need to integrate the zinc oxide as a active device with a specific device which usually required a high dielectric parameter, for example, strontium titanium oxide, that would have a perovskite, a cubic structure. So in order to investigate the interface between a hexagonal film with a cubic substrate, we actually choose a simpler cubic structure magnesium oxide. And actually some people also study the alloy of magnesium oxide and zinc oxide in order to tune the band gap for a wider application. Okay, so our first project is actually to use cubic magnesium oxide to grow WhatsApp, the hexagonal zinc oxide, and we were actually able to tune the growth orientations of this zinc oxide, which I will share the result later. And then later on, we also conduct another project, which is just inverse. In these cases, we use hexagonal zinc oxide as the substrate to grow the cubic functional oxide, for example, zinc oxide, okay? So the first exciting result is that we will actually be able to grow the hexagonal zinc oxide on top of the cubic magnesium oxide. And interestingly, just by tuning the, let me move this, just by tuning the substrate temperature, keeping other conditions the same, okay, we will actually be able to grow either the polar zinc oxide or non-polar zinc oxide. When we say polar, we mean that the zinc and oxygen are not in the same layer. So that will result in the internal electronic field inside the material along this C-axis direction. And then for non-polar plane, the zinc and oxygen atoms are on the same plane. Okay, so it's very interesting that we can just tune the substrate temperature and grow a different orientation of the hexagonal zinc oxide. And then later on, we explore more growth conditions and then found that and come up with this phase diagram. And then so next we'll try to investigate several questions related to this phase diagram. First, what would be the interface structure from the cubic substrate to the hexagonal subfilm? Okay, that's the first question. The other question is why? What's the mechanism for polar plane to appear in this region and then for non-polar plane to appear in this region? Okay. And then later on, we also calibrate the optic properties, and we are delighted to find that although we grow the hexagonal zinc oxide on top of a cubic substrate, but the resulted zinc oxide actually can achieve a bug-like optical properties. That's very encouraging. And of course, here we try also to tune the substrate temperature to test the effect of substrate temperature on the optical properties. And also we perform X-ray absorption spectroscopy to identify the fingerprint features that would be related to the polar and non-polar film, because that's quite related to the crystal orientation. And then by combining the density functional theory calculation, we can relate them to the existence of PXY or PZ states that makes the difference of the features in this spectrum. Okay, so for this interface structure, first we found that there are two domains appearing in the hexagonal zinc oxide, the polar case, okay? And then this is actually how they would rotate. In this hexagonal symmetry, 30 degrees and 90 degrees is actually equivalent. So you just rotate then you will get another different rotation. And for the case of polar zinc oxide, actually we've identified four of them, okay? So this is how you will see, because for the polar, non-polar film, you actually see the polar CS is along the other directions. Okay, if we look at this one, okay, this is sort of the template from the substrate. So you will see like this substrate provide four identical, four set of template for the non-polar zinc oxide to grow. So you will expect four different rotations on top of that. So we then perform scanning, transmission electron microscopy to identify the interface between the cubic substrate and the hexagonal films. And then here we also identify two domains for the polar film and also four domains for the non-polar film. Okay, and very interesting today, if we look at the theoretical predictions by this PRL paper, it says about in what cases it would expect the rotational domains. They actually provide a formula for us to calculate like how many rotational domains you would expect if we grow one kind of symmetry on top of a substrate with a different symmetry. Okay, so using this formula, we will actually be able to calculate that for polar cases, we would expect two rotational domains. And for non-polar cases, we would expect four different domains. That's exactly what we observe from the experiments. Okay, so coming back to this phase diagram, we want to understand why at lower temperature and all higher oxygen pressure, we'll be able to grow polar film, and while the other cases, we grow the non-polar film. So we conduct density functional theory calculation, basically study this case in two aspects. One is the thermodynamically way, in which cases we calculated the nucleation barrier of this polar film and non-polar film. And we do found that at lower temperature, the nucleation barrier for polar films is lower than that for the non-polar film. So it makes sense that at lower temperature, we grow this polar film. For kinetically, we also calculate the energy required for the zinc to be absorbed on the MgO, and also for the oxygen to be diffused. Okay, and we found out that with this higher temperature, okay, we'll be able to the environment will be suitable for nonpolar film to be closed. Okay, all right. So this is a quick summary about this project, saying that first, we are able to grow hexagonal zinc oxide on top of a cubic magnesium oxide and with high quality. When we say high quality, we say maybe spark-like, okay, optoelectronic properties. And then we think that this can be a model system for the integration of hexagonal zinc oxide on top of other cubic oxides. Also, interestingly, we can tuned the growth of polar and nonpolar zinc oxide films on the same magnesium oxide just by controlling the substrate temperature. Okay, and then now I would like to quickly move to the other project, which is the other way. Like in this case, we will use hexagonal zinc oxide to grow nickel oxide, which is cubic. Actually, our initial plan was to grow hexagonal zinc oxide. Hexagonal nickel oxide, because there's a theoretical prediction saying that for hexagonal zinc nickel oxide, maybe it would exhibit half metal properties, and also the magnetic properties might be different from the stable cubic nickel oxide, which is the AFM. Okay, anti-ferromagnetic. So we actually use this hexagonal zinc oxide in order to see whether we can grow hexagonal zinc oxide. However, it turns out that our nickel oxide is cubic. Okay, but it's okay for our case because I mean this is scientific research. Even though we cannot achieve hexagonal nickel oxide, but still we want to investigate the interface between a cubic nickel oxide and the hexagonal zinc oxide. And our plan is to grow cubic nickel oxide on top of polar and nonpolar zinc oxide. And what I'm going to share today is the result from the polar nickel oxide. Okay, first of all, this is the experiment was done in the Beijing synchrotron radiation facility where there's a nice MBE chamber attached to the synchrotron facility. So you can do this, you can actually characterize the evolution of the electronic properties as we increase the film thickness. Okay, so the first result is, okay, number one, we do grow a cubic nickel oxide on top of a hexagonal zinc oxide. And in these cases, we observe three those rotational domains. Okay, and then if we refer back to the formula provided by the PRO paper, and then it's actually matched the calculation. And again, we use this STM to investigate the interface. And then here we also see some different domains. And in this project, we more focus on the electronic properties. Okay, so first of all, we use EOS because EOS is capable for probing the conduction band. So we'll see how the electronic structure changed from interface to the frame. Okay, and then here we can see some tiny change of this band position, which will be actually tell us the change of the nickel items at the interface. And if we use the S-ray absorption spectroscopy based in synchrotron, we can also obtain the band structure related to conduction band. So here we also characterize the evolution of the band structure as the function of frame thickness, and we also tune the substrate, the sample angle to see how the result will be affected. Okay, so this is the, this is actually quite similar to the result from EOS. Okay, so if we look at this oxygen KH spectrum, it's more interesting because the spectrum from the substrate zinc oxide is totally different from the one of the nickel oxide. And then if we see the between, we'll see how these different features would evolve from one end to the other end. And then we move to the the valence band area where we use core level SPS to for this. Of course, we'll see all this peak, the change of this peak as the function of frame thickness as well. But for this, we actually mainly use that to verify the thickness of the frame. And then more importantly is this ultraviolet photo emission spectroscopy, because it is near the framing level, which is more related to the interface. And then from here, we can also see how the features will change as the function of thin film. However, it's not that thick, not that obvious. So we use a modeling approach that I actually work on back in my PhD study period, in which cases we try to sort of extract the interface states, okay, by using surface sensitive photo emission, because the result that I presented earlier, for example, ultraviolet photo emission spectroscopy, those are interface, those are surface sensitive, and usually people would thought it cannot be used to probe the barrier interface state. But for our case, because we are able to characterize the evolution of this spectrum as a function of thickness. So by using a modeling approach, we will actually be able to determine what would be really the interface states. Okay. So the idea is, first, we assume there's no interface states. Okay. So each intensity of the intensity from each frame is actually just a contribution from the substrate and the and plus the contribution from the frame. But of course, we need to consider the attenuation by the frame thickness. So these green spectrums were what we obtained by just modeling without just assuming no interface states. Okay, so by looking at this, we cannot see much difference. However, if we take the difference between this experimental and modeling spectrum, we'll identify some difference. So that means that the modeling spectrum is not exactly the same as the experimental spectrum. So there should be some interface that's there. So then we also took the sequential difference spectrum from each frame. Okay, because when we grow, for example, the second frame, actually we need to consider the contribution from the first frame. So we sort of try to subtract the contribution from the first frame from the total frame. And then in that cases, we can actually just come out with the spectrum from each frame itself, okay? Not affected by other layers. So from here, we see that actually from the third frame, those features are quite different. similar to each other. If there's any interface that existing, we would think it would come from the first and the second thing, the thickness. So we can say from here, because this is in the growth time, and then by considering the growth rate that we determined before, we'll be able to figure out that the interface there is about 1.7 nanometer. Okay, that's from the experimental spectrum. Then now we further consider our modeling. So remember, this one is the assumption that there's no interface states. Okay, now if we consider interface states, this one will become much more complicated. And here we would have a model of the interface, and then was some there contributed by the substrate, and then some there contributed by the overlay. And by using this formula, we will actually be able to determine what will be the cases for this interface thickness. And the result is quite similar to what we have from this experimental spectrum. Okay, so all right, so another quick conclusion for the second project. First is that we saw that we will be able to grow cubic nickel oxide on top of hexagonal zinc oxide, despite that there's this mismatch between the structural symmetry. And also we identified some interface states between zinc oxide and nickel oxide. Of course, we also try to investigate what's the origin for these electronic states, okay? And then it might be due to some hybridization of the nickel and oxygen or charge transfer. Okay, that's what we thought. And in this project, we also saw that we can investigate the interface states by using electron-based space technique. For example, the EOS in STM, or the photon based technique, for example, this UPS and X-ray absorption spectroscopy. And in the future, we also perform a density functional theory to calculate the density of states for this interface for comparison. Okay, so here is the conclusion for my talk. So we saw you that we were able to grow cubic nickel oxide on top of hexagonal zinc oxide, or hexagonal zinc oxide on top of cubic magnesium oxide. And in fact, this is the same author of the PR paper, okay? They actually published another paper showing this nice mapping about this the rotational expectation. And then our case actually matches their theoretical prediction very well. Okay, and then also I would like to emphasize that we thought that it is very useful to combine the electron-based and photon-based probes to do characterization or investigation of these functional materials. And then if we can combine with density functional theory, then we can make a story more insightful. Okay, thank you so much for your attention. This is the end of my talk. And this is the nice, beautiful pictures from our universities.